We invite the esteemed panelist for today's session. Mustafiz, the Executive Director of CPD, is already here. Let me invite Dr. Ratnakar Adhikari, the head of the EIF Secretariat at WTO. May I invite Professor James Miller, from the research head and professor from Geneva Graduate Institute, and from FAIRD, one of the partner organizations of LDC IV Monitor. I would also invite Dr. Jody Keane from the Commonwealth Secretariat to join the panel. Please come over here. They're still missing the name. They're getting it done. We have a bit of a mix-up there. Please. And we are very privileged to have two very distinguished persons who have agreed to be the discussant for today's session. Ambassador Nicholas Imboden, from the head of the founder of the Idea Center in Geneva, and Professor Rodden Wilkinson from the Sussex University. I have them on the floor because that makes me look the session a bit fuller if they are down there. So that is the only reason, nothing else. You know, that's a logistical issue. As you know, today's session is very simple. It is the discussion will take place in the cross section, in the cross section of three themes. The first theme is the least developed countries and how they are integrating themselves in the multilateral international trading regime. So it is about the development challenges and concerns and interests of the least developed country, 49 of them. 16% of the population, less than 1% of the global trade, less than 2% of the global FDI, less than 0.5% of the global services exports. That's what they account for. So these marginal countries, what we are talking about. And when we talk about LDCs, it is not only about the low-income countries in that sense, but it is also about the landlocked countries, it is also about the SEEDs, the small island development state. We are talking about SVEs, the small vulnerable economies, and many more in that sense. So it is a microcosm of vulnerability and disadvantaged locational group of countries which are disadvantageously located. The second theme which we will talk about is that these countries, many of them, notwithstanding their diverse geographical location, economic attributes and endowments, they are also getting into the integration process of the global economy through regional cooperation. Regional cooperation has emerged as one of the major way of integrating into the global economy, and that concerns not only trade, of course trade is one of the ways, but also investment and flow of financial flows, labor mobility and many other things, along with peace, security and other issues. So regional cooperation is one of the major ways of their instruments for enhancing their development prospects. And the third issue is that in between, the idea of reducing trade cost has gained prominence, and we have since Bali ministerial, the Trade Facilitation Agreement. And it is considered the Trade Facilitation Agreement is going to help these low-income countries, LDCs, in enhancing their regional integration prospect by strengthening the trade facilitation border measures, behind the border measures, and many more things. And I have a list with me which shows almost two dozens of these kind of regional integrations are now involving least developed countries, particularly in the southern context. And the South-South cooperation is one of the ways, particular expression of that regional integration, and trade facilitation becomes an important input in terms of enhancing that. Regarding trade facilitation, we have specific aid for trade agenda also, and other than that, there are also nationally developed programs which are many international financial organizations are involved over there. So colleagues, this is today is the challenge of triangulation. Anybody who goes out of this, any of these three themes, and then obviously I'm going to intervene and stop them. But I'm pretty sure we have an excellent set of people here, and I have invited them not only because they're my good friends, but because they're good experts in this area. And you have to pick your friends right in that sense, so that you can invite them at beck and call to your sessions, and they oblige in this. That's why I'm very grateful to them. And colleagues, thank you very much for coming up in this morning. So to start the discussions, let me invite Mustafiz. The rule is 8 minutes over there, and it will be ruthlessly followed because I want to float discussion. And then I will bring in the two reflections from Mr. Imboden and Professor Wilkinson, and then we will open up the floor for comments and all your demolition jobs you want to do about these people who are sitting over here this morning. So let us make the morning fruitful. That's the whole challenge. Let's now that you are here, please engage yourself. Mustafiz, you have the floor. 8 minutes.
Good morning. Thank you, Deb, for that excellent introduction of the theme of discussion today. Dear guests, thank you for your presence this morning. As one of the co-hosts of this session, I'm really grateful for your participation. As Dev has mentioned, many of these developed countries are now trying to contribute to their economic development through regional integration. In fact, I was looking at the figures, and on average, amongst these developed countries, at least they are members of 4 regional trading arrangements of one sort of another: preferential, free trade, customs union. So regional integration is being seen by the developed countries as a vehicle for global integration, for regional integration, and for economic development and socio-economic welfare. So from that perspective, I think trade facilitation is the last great barrier which they will have to surmount. Because regional integration is giving them opportunity to bring down their tariffs, but the non-tariff barriers and non-tariff measures are the ones which are really holding them back. And from that perspective, trade facilitation agreement, which was signed in Bali and being ratified now by the various countries, is so important for the least developed countries. But I would like to also expand the definition a bit. Trade facilitation agreement, as in W2, has been criticized as import facilitation agreement, because many of the least developed countries and developing countries were looking at it as more or less of customs facilitation. So I would say that we should look from the least developed country perspective, at least, as a triangulation. Trade facilitation as a triangulation, as Deb has mentioned the word, but this triangulation is between trade connectivity, investment connectivity, and transport connectivity. I would like to look at trade facilitation as the triangulation of these 3 connectivities, and from that perspective, I think that that the least developed countries, in order to get into the regional integration and also to take the advantage of regional integration for global integration from a position of strength, is very important. If we look at, for example, my own region, SAARC, the intra-regional trade in SAARC is only 5% of our global trade, whereas in ASEAN it is about 30%, in NAFTA it is about 56%, in European Union it is about 67%. One of the major reasons is that trading within South Asia, for example, where there are 3 landlocked countries, is more costlier than trading with European Union. If we want to really export something to New Delhi from Dhaka, it is more costlier than exporting from Dhaka to, say, London or Amsterdam. So that is the reason. And one of the major reasons is that most of the trade amongst the least developed countries in the context of regional integration is done through land customs stations. And there, the major trade facilitation barriers are there. For example, within the SAARC countries, if we take tariff equivalent, intra-SAARC cost of trade is 114% equivalent of our tariffs. It is in, if we take ASEAN, it is only 76%. If we take East Asia, it is only 55%. So the cost of trading within the region is very high. And it is because the customs points are not crossing points. They are control points. They are choking points. And that's why the cost of trading within the region becomes so high. And that's why the trade facilitation agreement, which has been signed in Bali, is also very important. If we take the 38 points, you know, customs clearance, paperless trade, you know, dispute settlement mechanism, coordination and harmonization of the standards across the borders, if we take all these, we'll find that there are a lot of obstacles over there, and it leads to delays, it leads to cost escalation. I'll give you just one example from the ESCAP trade and investment report of this year. If we have paperless trade across the border, then the time can be reduced in Asia-Pacific region by 24%, the direct cost can be reduced by 17%, the cost savings will be about $7 billion, and it will lead to an additional intra-Asia-Pacific region trade of $250 billion. So those are the numbers that we are talking about. If you look at the Commonwealth flagship report of this year, and they do an estimate of the logistics performance indicators, and they show that if the Commonwealth countries have the same logistic performance indicators as South Africa, then the GDP of Commonwealth countries will increase by $177 billion. Intra-communal trade will increase by $158 billion, and there will be 24 million additional jobs. So these are the numbers which are really very important. So what should we do? Because if we cannot really have the trade facilitation, particularly small and medium enterprises, if you look at the export figures of many of our least developed countries, you will see that many exporters, they export once or twice and then they stop exporting. And one of the major reasons the service tell is that the border crossings are so difficult. In many of the countries, in South Asia, for example, 90% of our trade, Bangladesh's trade with India, is through land. And you have to take the goods to the border, then reload it, head carry it to the other side, reload it into other trucks, and then go. So there's a lot of wastage, lot of time delays and cost escalation. Small and medium enterprises cannot do that. And that's why we see that the value chains and the supply chains within the regions where the LDCs are majorities, in South Asia, in the SARC, for example, Afghanistan, Nepal and Bhutan are landlocked countries. They are out of this 48 LDCs, there are 17 LDCs at the landlocked countries. So there is the problem. So the value chains and the supply chains cannot be developed across the region basing on comparative advantages because the cost of intra-industry trade is so high. So I think that the issue here is that we have to develop paperless trade across the border. We have to develop single windows within our own countries. There has to be more coordination between the countries, because if you do your single window but the other side doesn't, then it is as bad as it was before. So a lot of coordination has to be done across the border between the custom systems. So harmonization is very important. Coordination is very important. So that is one. The other thing is that in many of the least developed countries, in the context of the regional trading arrangements, there are a lot of, now at least in South Asia and the Asian region, there are a lot of corridor, economic corridors which are being developed. In the context of South Asia, we have the Bangladesh, China, India, Myanmar economic corridor, the BCIM corridor. We have done the sub-regional motor vehicle agreements, and many of the least developed countries are doing those type of things. But if we don't have the trade facilitation to carry the goods across the borders with single windows, paperless trade, I think that we cannot really translate our comparative advantages into competitive advantages and take the advantage of more value chain and more value chain exchanges, more supply chain network development. So without those, I think that least developed countries will not be able to really not only integrate in regionally, but taking advantage of that, getting into the globalization process from a position of strength. So that's why trade facilitation, both in the narrow term and the broader term, is so important. Thank you.
Thank you, Mustafiz. I think that was an excellent exposition of the theme and giving us the very convincing figures in terms of the need for trade facilitation for furthering not only regional integration but taking advantage of the comparative advantages of these economies located in various parts of Asia, Africa and elsewhere. I think Mustafiz has given us a new definition of triangulation, which should become the subject matter for trade facilitation, the connectivity, transport connectivity, trade connectivity, and investment connectivity. That was an interesting triangulation which was necessary. And he said that this triangulation is being strangulated by the border measures in some way. The strangulation is there in that way. My question to Mustafizur had been, if I had been on an opportunity letter, is that if it is so convincing in terms of number, why it is not happening? What are the impediments? What is the incentive failure? Maybe the answers will be given by the discussant. And the second one is the cost issue, how much it is going to cost. These are the two issues. And you can be pretty sure you'll get the answer by the time my panel completes. Let me invite Professor Jim DiMello. He's the scientific director at the FERDI, which is in France. But he had been teaching long in Geneva. But more importantly, he has done lot of empirical work on trade facilitation in the context of LDCs, and in particular aid for trade. Jim, please, your eight minutes of glory.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you for inviting me. I suppose you all know about the aid for trade initiative, how it was somewhat of some of us call a success, because it sort of arrested the decline in the share of aid for trade in official development assistance. At the same time, we know that the system that we use to classify aid for trade, the CRS, is full of errors. But taking these numbers for what they are, about 1% of it, 10% of it is going to soft infrastructures, which is what we're talking about here, and 1% of that is classified as trade facilitation. So what I would like to do is to spend a few minutes trying to do what we have all been talking about recently, which is to move ahead from counting. As you know, the first evaluations of aid for trade was to count how many times could you find the word trade in the annual budget speech, to go towards sort of a little bit more measuring. So that's essentially what was one of the criticisms of aid for trade in the latest OECD WTO reviews. And the trade facilitation agreement is a great opportunity to get back aid for trade on track. I mean by that is to go towards objectives that are more easily measured, and that's what we need to get support for aid for trade. As you know, the aid for trade was there in part to raise funds more than to do something really to help the country. So this is what I would like to talk about for a few minutes, concentrating on LDCs and landlocked LDCs. So what are the issues? Well, the issues here are that the aid for trade, as you know, initiative is now the trade facilitation, they all seem the same. It's not aid for trade, it's trade facilitation initiative in Bali, is to improve the soft infrastructure, reduce trade red tape, strengthen the Article 10 on transfer, improve international cooperation. And by the way, improving international cooperation is also important for the SDGs, and that means, of course, doing something at the borders to cooperate more and have less illegal trade. That's also part of something that is somewhat neglected, but should be taken into account. So what did we do? Well, what we did, we first looked at trade costs, as has been discussed earlier. And when you look at the decline in trade costs have been falling everywhere. The problem is they've been falling relatively less rapidly in LDCs and landlocked LDCs than elsewhere. So if they've been falling less rapidly, since all it is relative, if you want to meet the Istanbul Program of Action, and meeting that means doubling the export share of LDCs by 2020, then somehow you have to have trade costs there that have to be falling roughly twice as fast as for the competitors. So that's a really big challenge, and it's very good to try and keep our eyes on that, how important trade costs are, because we know the trade cost is what's going to determine, among others, the volume of trade. So what do we do? Well, we're very lucky. We used to only have doing business data, and doing business data is what it's worth. It's better than not having it at all, but we know it's only two or three freight forwarders per country. The data isn't really that good. It's still maybe the best we have. So what we like to know is how much time is being spent at the borders and trying to measure that. So we've been lucky to have the OECD come up in 2011 and now in 2015 with trade facilitation indicators. These trade facilitation indicators are not perfect, but we have them for 180 countries. And the exercise we have in the PowerPoint that I prepared was to look at what are the values of these indices, 11 of them, taking the average or whatever you want, by groups of developing countries. So you have 90 developing countries. You take the other developing countries, then you do the LDCs, then you do landlocked LDCs, and so on. And what you always find is these indicators are have better values for the other LDCs than for the LDCs, other developing countries better than LDCs, which are better than landlocked LDCs. So the next question is, you know, can we take some of the estimates that we have on what is the equivalent in trade costs of having more time spent at the border? And that's what the trade facilitation agreement is, improving customs. Customs is not everything, but that's part of the game. So what we do know more or less, I mean, there's a big margin of error, it's 1 to 2% is points of trade costs for one extra day. So if you spend one extra day in transit from origin to destination, it might cost between 1 and 2, 2.5%. So then what we can do is do a whole series of calculations and try to see, you know, what is, you know, what is the penalty or the disadvantage of different categories of countries. So if you do the LDCs versus the landlocked, what you do find is that the landlocked LDCs have a greater trade cost from delays in transit than the LDCs, which themselves are higher than the non-LDC. And that is an order of magnitude important. You say, what is 4%? Well, 4% for the landlocked LDCs versus 2.5% for the LDCs. Well, maybe it's not that much, but today there's a lot of competition in the globalized world. So 4% could be really a lot. Oh, wait, this is the type of measurement that we're looking into. So what we try to do then after that is to try and look at the better data that we have on the time that is spent in customs and to see how these are related to these indicators. Now, what the statistical analysis try to do, and it's far from perfect, but just to give rough orders of magnitude and I'll stop, is just to say, well, okay, we know that how much time you spend in customs depends on many things, okay? We know also that the time of transit also depends on geography, okay? If you're landlocked, you know, nothing you can do about it. It depends also on your, call it government indicators, okay? Whatever those are, they may be measured imperfectly, but also on how customs function. So what we do is we can try and estimate, you know, how much time you're spending in transit, taking into account your geography, taking into account other factors that determine the time that you spend, and then adding in the indicator values that I mentioned from the OECD, database. If you do this, sounds a bit arcane maybe, but then at the end you can say, well, what would you gain in terms of reduced trade costs if in your own category, that is if landlocked LDCs, the median or the mean landlocked LDC was to move to the frontier of the LDC category or the landlocked to its own frontier of landlocked countries, how much would trade costs be reduced? And that was what the exercise was about. And just to stop here, it's not an issue of numbers, but it's just of orders of magnitude. And the orders of magnitude show, or suggest at least, that LDCs and landlocked LDCs would gain relatively more from trade facilitation. And therefore, that's a good reason to do that. And the last point, maybe perhaps the most important for aid for trade in the future, is that it's relatively easy to measure it, relatively easy, meaning that if you want to go towards aid for trade that is based on results, then it'll be much easier to evaluate aid for trade. Thank you.
Thank you, Jim. I think that was a very insightful intervention telling us about the trade cost issues and bringing in the OECD trade facilitation data set into use. And I just what comes to my mind is that in some way that the trade costs in the LDCs would be higher than in the developing countries, and within the LDCs, the trade cost of the landlocked would be higher. It's very pro-intuitive in some way. Huh? Wouldn't that be in that? But the this is one question which yesterday in one of the sessions which Commonwealth and UNCTAD organized yesterday, and I think Dr. Razak was giving to to Bernard, Professor Bernard Hookman, that the structural constraint of the LDCs, the landlocked LDCs, makes it somehow obvious that they are going to have higher trade costs, given they will be using transit countries in one way or another, which adds to their cost, and because border crossings are involved. So whether it becomes a, you know, by default that they would be always in a structural disadvantage or not, and how do we deal with that? I leave that question to you. I'm sure you can bring that issue back over there. Now, from the general issue of trade facilitation, regional integration, connectivity, and LDCs, we have moved to the aid for trade, how aid for trade can help. Now we are going to move within the aid for trade into EIF, specifically how the only designated window for aid for trade for the LDCs are going to play a role in ameliorating these circumstances. What is the experience, and now that they have gathered fresh bunch of money 2 days back for the second phase, we will know what is going to happen in the future. So we have Ratnakar, no less than a person, Ratnakar Adhikari, to tell us that.
Thank you very much, David, for your kind introduction of the subject, as well as for setting the context. What I would like to do in the next 8 minutes is to make 4 points and divide them 2 minutes, 2 minutes each. First, I'll discuss about how the EIF works in general. And second is the trade support, the trade facilitation report related support that provide to LDCs through this mechanism, and how effective or ineffective it has been. And the third is the regional dimension. Now we move as we move into the second phase of the program, we are sort of going ahead with the regional dimension, and I'd like to briefly explain that as well, and the some of the trade facilitation issues would also feature there. And finally, just leave with the thoughts on other channels for support. And there I would like to emphasize the role of South-South cooperation. Just a food for thought. Let me explain how the EIF works in practice in general. What we do is conduct an analytical study at the country level. And this is called DTIS, Diagnostic Trade Integration Studies, which is there to sort of find out what are the opportunities and challenges facing the LDCs in terms of their integration into the global economy, and as well as into the regional markets. And we identify then priority actions that need to be undertaken, and this is then codified under what is known as action matrix. And that actually list down some of the reform measures that need to be undertaken, and it also lists down possible project ideas through which, you know, the support would be then provided at a later stage. Then we also provide support to the countries through the institutional and policy channel, and this support is provided essentially for the LDCs to create the necessary institutional structure to manage their trade and development agenda, to manage the aid for trade resources. What we do at the country level is to set up a multi-stakeholder institutional body called National Steering Committee, where you have representation not only from the Ministry of Trade, but also from other sectoral ministry, planning, finance, other ministry, and then you have representation from the private sector, as well as civil society organization. And that body is responsible for steering the EIF agenda at the country level. Then we also have implementing arm, which is called National Implementation Unit, often housed within the Ministry of Trade. They are responsible for implementing the guidance provided by the steering committee. And then the third window of support that we provide to the LDCs is the catalytic project support, and these are aimed at addressing their supply side constraint. Some of the support that we provide, infrastructure, and includes infrastructure support that we provide, comes through this window, and this support is provided based on the priority identified through the analytical work. And it has to be a bankable project, and it has to demonstrate that it would be sustainable in the future, and it has to demonstrate that it is able to, it is or will be in a position to leverage additional resources. So that's how we work. And in terms of TS support, TF support in general, there are possible three windows, and this actually relate to the three windows that I explained earlier. And the first one is one of the feasibility study window through which we can conduct need assessment at the country level. If we are talking about the implementation of trade facilitation agreement or otherwise, we want to know as to what are the needs and priorities of the countries in relation to trade facilitation. If there are some other infrastructure that are already in place, they have the necessary policy and institutional apparatus in place, then we don't need to fund those, right? But what are the other things and what are the gaps that needs to be identified? And the moment we come to know about these, then we provide them support for capacity building, policy measures, and these kind of supports were provided to a country like Cambodia, where we provided them the initial support, institutional support, through which they created this mechanism called trade sector-wide approach. And that trade sector-wide approach then invested resources into trade facilitation, which actually resulted in the import time, the installation of Ashikuta that resulted in import time from reduced from 45 days to 26 days. Then we also provide catalytic support, as I mentioned earlier, and this catalytic support is to support real and tangible projects. For example, we are supporting Maldives for strengthening their custom and civil aviation infrastructure, where trade facilitation reform, including installation of Ashikuta, these are the major components, and we are supporting these with the expectation that there will be substantial reduction in time taken for import and export. In the Gambia, we are supporting a different kind of project because the Gambia realized that they have a very good vegetable and horticulture production, but they are unable to export even to the regional market because they want to airlift those articles, but they don't have the necessary facility within the airport. Then we supported them to create air cargo logistics infrastructure, and there's a component of trade facilitation there, and we also provide capacity building training to the officials in order to make sure that they are able to export effectively at a reduced cost through the air cargo facility. And then the third project that we are supporting is in Rwanda. This is called cross-border market project, where we create the trade facilitation infrastructure at the border point between Burundi and Rwanda on the other hand, and between Rwanda and DRC on the other hand, to support the trade facilitation, as well as providing training to the traders who cross the border and export their product. The third issue is the regional dimension. I fully agree with Mustafiz when he mentioned that for LDCs, regional integration is a very important avenue to diversify their export, as well as to enhance their exportability and export some of these products in a competitive manner. This is even more so important, as you have rightly pointed out, in the context of the global value chain and regional value chain emerging. So given the fact that this is so important, we realize that this is something that we would like to take up in the second phase of the EIF. And the first thing that we did was to organize a workshop in Banjul, the Gambia, in June last year, where we organized it together with UNCTAD, and we gathered representatives from Mali, Gambia, Senegal, Burkina Faso, and Niger to discuss about the challenges they face to integrate themselves better at the regional level, even despite the fact that they have this ECOWAS arrangement in place. The trade, the intra-regional trade is not very impressive. So therefore, we wanted to identify the challenges, and some of the major challenges they identified related to trade facilitation. And another challenge they identified related to transit facilitation, because they mentioned clearly that despite the presence of this interstate road transport convention within the region, because of the poor implementation of this convention, they were unable to take advantage of regional integration. And then what we then thought was that, okay, this is an idea. As we move into the second phase, we want to do it. And then we engaged our consultant, who happens to be none other than Bernard Hochman, to do a study on how the EIF could provide support to the regional project. Because initially we couldn't provide support to any regional project because our clients were the LDCs countries and we could only provide support to individual LDCs. So when it comes to the regional level, you know, you don't know whom to provide support to. So therefore, and based on the study that study and the recommendation that Professor Hochman provided, now we are moving to the second phase with the possibility of supporting trade facilitation, the regional integration agenda as well, and within that trade facilitation as well. What we can do, for example, let me explain with the help of an example. In the context of East Africa, if we want to support Burundi, Rwanda, Uganda, and Tanzania, we can do so. We can also support Kenya to the extent that we are doing an analytical work. But when it comes to providing support for, infrastructure, then we cannot provide support to Kenya because it's a developing country. We only provide support to the LDC. So this kind of analytical work, including a possibility of conducting a regional DTIS, exist now, and then this is probably something that we're going to do. So I'll wrap up with the final point, Mr. Moderator, that there are other channels also. This is not the only channel. I mean, the 8-4 Trade Initiative that we mentioned, the Global Alliance that is going to be launched today, then the WTO have Trade Facilitation Agreement Facility, then the World Bank has a Trade Facilitation Facility. But there's one point that I emphasize is that's the role of South-South cooperation, and this is quite critical for us to understand because it's not only at the regional level but also at the bilateral level things are happening, and that results in a relatively better off country providing support, transfer of the skill and knowledge to the LDCs, and then capacity building and design of law and policy and infrastructure support if required for the creation of juxtaposed border post at some point that would be possible through South-South cooperation. I'll stop there. Sorry.
Thank you, Ratnakar. I think that was an excellent 8-minute exposition of EIF in action, and Ratnakar did it so well. And if I would have given you more time, then people would consider that it is a South-South cooperation. So I couldn't give you more time on that. But I would repeat only one question and give you 10 seconds to respond to that. What Mustafiz asked you yesterday, and you didn't get a chance to respond. You have raised $90 million against an expectation of $300 million. How do you plan to fill up the rest, and do you expect those money to flow in the current upcoming years?
Do you want me to respond now?
Yes, 15 seconds.
Oh, 15. No. I need 45 seconds to respond. What we've done is that $270 million to $320 million was the budget for a 7-year period. What we have mobilized now to begin with, it would be for 2 years, 2.5 years period. And after 2.5 years, we will have to organize a replenishment conference. That's one. Second is that there are some donors who, because of their election cycles or their budgetary cycles, were unable to commit, and they have actually come back to us, and they have also indicated that they will be in a position to support. There are some other donors who would like to see result on the ground of the reform process that has been undertaken as we move into the second phase of the program, and would like to see more results on the ground on the basis of which they would be able to place more. So I'm quite confident that this EIF mechanism would be fully funded.
Okay, very good. That's a good news. And colleagues, please put in your proposals to EIF to get funded. They're in a comfortable situation. Colleagues, now I'm going to round out the panel with Dr. Jody Keane, formerly with ODI, currently with Commonwealth Secretariat, one of our good friends and expert who plays a critical role in analyzing LDC issues in various ways. And one of my issues to Jody had been that now that we have gone down 3 stages, having gone from the aggregate level analysis to 8-4 trade facilitation to EIF trade facilitation. Now, Jody, pull it up again back to the bigger framework. the global agenda, which is coming up as the SDG, there is the IPOA and many other things. How this is all going to relate to that? You want to say anything you want to, along with this one, please. 8 minutes, anyway.
Yeah, thank you very much for the kind introduction, Deb, and good morning, everyone. There's one main point that I want to get across to you today in my intervention, and this is that we need to give dual consideration to both the trade cost element, but also the capabilities element. And I'm always struck by how this the aspect of capabilities seems to be somewhat neglected, but all of the interventions have touched upon the issue here this morning. So just in terms of the link between LDCs, trade facilitation, and regional integration, I found this subject really interesting in view of the development of capabilities, productive capacity, the achievement of structural economic transformation, which is one of the main objectives of the LDCs as reflected in the Istanbul Programme of Action going forward. So I found the subject really interesting, Deb, so thanks for bringing us all here today to discuss it. And so when you consider regional integration, the special role that regional integration can play in terms of helping this structural economic transformation process along, we have to be kind of mindful of the type of interventions that we are advocating, and also give due consideration in terms of sequencing and in terms of prioritizing. So just run through three main points now. So our experience, the experience of my colleagues in the Trade Competitive Programme in the Commonwealth Secretariat, they've been involved in trying to introduce the Tier Carnet system in the East African region. And they're kind of piloting, they're looking at feasibility studies at the moment. And of course, this system makes good economic sense. You know, it can reduce costs. You need one document in order to pass through multiple borders, and it's also cheap and it's globally recognised. So of course it makes sense, it can help to reduce trade costs, but where the project, it's not struggling, but it has to give due consideration as to how to institutionalise this mechanism, and that requires kind of linking up respective chambers of commerce, customs authorities and so on. So it really draws attention to this issue around capabilities. So not only is this, you need this kind of regional approach towards negotiating effectively to obtain resources for your trade facilitation efforts, you also really need this regional apparatus to be in place in order to effectively implement. Now, our analysis on trade costs, it shows there's clearly lots of low-hanging fruit for LDCs in sub-Saharan Africa. We know that, you know, trade costs for African LDCs, they're very high. For Africa as a region, trade costs are twice as high as other regions. And we're working with Ben Shepherd, who I know does a lot of work on this issue. There are some differences, though, in the sectors. And there are some differences in terms of trade costs between African countries on an intra-regional basis. And we also know that the composition of products traded on an inter-regional basis differs to those products traded on world markets. Okay, so there's more manufacturing, more processed goods being traded on an intra-regional basis rather than on an extra-regional basis. So when we're thinking about the interventions, you know, to improve logistics performance, air transport connectivity, linear shipping connectivity, you know, there's clearly a lot of work that can be done there. And we also have to think carefully, I think, about sequencing and priorities, okay, in terms of the LDC's objectives to achieve structural economic transformation. And that is why the role of intra-regional trade does play a very, I would say, a special role in terms of this developmental objective. So just move now to my kind of final point. And this relates to giving due consideration not only to needs assessments, but also to impact assessments. And for LDCs, you know, in particular, these monitoring and evaluation frameworks are extremely weak. We don't have the data, and, you know, I'm I've been quite shocked by this in the past. You know, you're negotiating trade agreements, but you don't really understand how different groups may be affected by those interventions, how different sectors may be affected by those interventions, and how that these interventions may affect the kind of future trajectory of structural economic transformation. And it's something that the group is the IPOA and LDC IV monitoring group, it's something we've also discussed. So in terms of, you know, we know that there's a bit of a gap in terms of monitoring interventions by development partners and thinking about these monitoring and evaluation frameworks. So I think I'll end on that and pass to the other commentators.
Thank you, Jodi. I think that was a very useful introduction of the term capability along with the trade cost and how they two interact with each other and whether the capability is, this is a chicken and egg issue in some ways, whether you need to have capabilities in order to reduce your trade cost or in the process of reducing trade cost you generate your capacities in the practice. So, this is a very difficult territory. I have no views on that. And also on the assessment issue, this is also critical, because in most cases, so for all these important, you know, experts sitting here and in front of us, most of us, we have done ex ante assessment about how much, benefit it will all generate if you do this or the other intervention. But very few do an ex post analysis and say that I was proven wrong, the benefit had been much less or much more. So. Even that is true for the WTO agreements, because there is hardly any ex post analysis of the benefits of the WTO agreements. It's methodologically challenging. But anyway, thank you very much for all those things. Colleagues, you will have to now listen to two very good interventions which will come from our two eminent discussants. You know, why do you have discussants in this kind of seminars? The moderator cannot really criticize the presenters. I have been doing all the appreciations, you know. So you pick up two people who can very sweetly do the criticism in that way. So let me begin with Nicholas Imboden. Hey, Nicholas, please, you come over here. You're 5 minutes.
Thank you, Deb, and thank you very much for including me here. For gentle criticism, I'm not the right person, as you know, and I am rather straightforward and direct. But here I'm a little bothered for two reasons. One is, you know, when I told my friends that I had to discuss here on the TFA and how it does it and things, I said, you know, I really don't really like to do that because I'm not a TFA specialist. And my colleagues answered, well, what's the problem? You have been an ambassador. You are used to talk about things you don't understand. So don't worry. The second reason is that it's quite difficult here to comment this very rich discussion that we had here. And I will actually make first three comments. And then, since I am a good student of my mentor, Depp, I will actually follow his instruction and respond to the two questions that he has put up. The first thing I wanted to say, about 20 years ago, when I was a government official, I went to Ivory Coast with a private sector mission to see about the cooperation between Switzerland and the Ivory Coast. And one of the members was Nestlé. And Nestlé has a factory in the Ivory Coast. And we were discussing, and he said, well, you know, we are producing here in Ivory Coast the same thing we are producing in England. But when we export this product to Senegal, we export it from England because it is cheaper than doing it from the Ivory Coast. And before coming here, you know, or after the TFA agreement and so on, I called this guy and said, well, you know, 20 years after, we have now a customs union, the ECOWAS, in the region. How did it affect your work? He said, well, it's the same. We still export from Great Britain. There are zero tariffs. Why was it? It is trade facilitation. It's the cost was the cost of crossing borders and the logistics. I believe that trade facilitation is a wrong term. It should be called investment facilitation. Because in reality, trade facilitation allows the countries to get investments. Let me say a second element that I thought was very interesting. A friend of mine is working for the Singaporean government. What they are trying to do is to define industrial policy. They are a small country, they are a few people. They want to be in a high value chain. So they are defining a product where they are producing just the very high value products. And they are looking how to source out their products. And they go into all countries, and the only thing they are looking at is how long and how much it costs to get it to Singapore. So it is the global value chain. If you are not able to produce the product at a cost, you know, that the transport is allowing it to become part of another product, and especially within the time constraints that you need, you are out of the chain. So it is really, trade facilitation is as much about investment than it is about trade. Now, I want to come to the third element is very simple, and say, you know, trade facilitation has really, in my opinion, three elements. That's customs, transports, and logistics. I'm working in one country, Laos, very much, which is doing a lot in trade facilitation. But their major problem is actually transport, because their trucks cannot go from one to the other. They have to be unloaded and loaded on a Thai truck. We changed that, and there is an agreement that actually they can go back and forth now. But the port in Thailand still requests that only Thai trucks come in. So you still have the break of the line. So the logistics and how you organize it is very, very important. Now let me come to the two questions that Deb asked. You know, we are all agreeing, you know, the benefits are great compared to the cost. The internal rate of return of these investments is fantastic. So why it is not happening? I think there are some very good or simple reasons. You know, one is interest. If I am producing for the local market, you know, I have a fantastic protection. As we all know, it's actually a bigger protection than the tariffs. So, you know, I'm not really interested to get rid of that. If I am, I have a monopoly in my country, I like this problems of trade. Secondly, it creates monopolies. And monopolies are a beneficial element for those who profit from it. So, you know, I have no interest to do it. Thirdly, you know, in the customs, you know, trade facilitation means a lot of revenue, because it is really also a governance issue. Because one of the benefits of trade facilitation is that there's no more direct contact between the one who makes the decision and the one who pays the fees. So there are many, many less opportunities of trying to extract some extra money. So you lose revenue. And you lose jobs, because if you are making it easier, you will have less people, you will have more technology, etc. So they are against it. Moreover, one of the issues is that the costs are hidden. You know, nobody has to pay there is no payment for trade costs. It's included in the price. It's hidden. The customer pays it. So it's not as visible as a tariff. A tariff, you know, I have to come out and I have to pay $50 or whatever it is. Trade costs, I don't have to pay. You know, it just is a cost that is given to the consumer or to the producer. So there is no big lobby against it. So I think the last one is really a question that was addressed by Jody, is this capacity issue and the fact of coordination, because basically most of those issues require coordination and clear priorities. Now, the second question was the cost factor. You know, here I have a very strong feeling. Everybody is always talking about the cost factor. I think it's irrelevant for two reasons. One, there are two types of costs. There are software and hardware costs. And the software costs are relatively small. The hardware costs are very big. And when I look at certain things, I looked at a study made by ECOWAS about getting the products from the landlocked countries down through the corridors to the ocean. The cost of soft elements was very, very high. And they were looking afterwards, well, we need to create a highway. And the highway costs were very high. But actually, the benefits of the highway were lower than the elements of the software issues that were to be addressed. So costs are not the first element, I think, now to be considered. Second point is, there is a lot of money around for TFA, for trade facilitation. Quite frankly said, I never understood why LDCs still ask always to replenish the facility of the WTO. As it was said before, you know, EIF has money for that, the World Bank has a facility, all those people have money. And that is very important. The last point is, trade facilitation can be made without any costs to the government. Because you can use the private sector for doing it. When I was working in the private sector, we had a project in Ghana to create a paperless customs union, a customs system. And we did it at zero cost to the government, because basically the private sector was very willing to pay a certain percentage of the cost, because it was much less than what they had. With that, I am finished. Thank you.
Thank you. I think there is very specific two answers. One is that why it is not happening, notwithstanding all the empirical data which is so convincingly showing that it is useful to have trade facilitation. One, according to Nicholas, one is the issue of incentive failure of individuals and the institutions, and the second one is the deficit, capacity deficit in many ways in that way. My only question is that you said the friend whom you called was in Senegal? The Nestle?
Huh?
Ivory Coast. I wonder if you call the gentleman or the lady after next 20 years, what would be the answer? I will run a poll over here. How many of you are pessimists and how many of you? And that is the assessment which we will do. But we have Rodin already on this space. You know, Rodin, please, the big view.
Thank you, Deb. It won't be a big view, actually, I'm afraid. I'm going to change track here. Normally, I would either say some words as an economist or as a political scientist. But actually, what I'm going to say makes me more of an anthropologist than any of the others. I'm actually going to not do what Deb has asked me to do. He asked me to critique the two of these papers. And I found myself listening to Jody's paper thinking, that's absolutely right. It's capabilities that really matter. I want to just throw into the conversation a few things that we forget about when we think about trade facilitation. When we think about trade facilitation, inevitably we are thinking about an agreement in the World Trade Organization about customs bureaucracies, but we seldom actually think about how you enable small traders to engage in trading activity across borders. And doing that in a way that has multiplier spillover effects in local environments. And that's what really matters. Now, these may well result in very small gains, but very small gains become slightly bigger gains, which themselves roll into even bigger gains. So I'd like to say a few things about that. I'd also like to make a bit of a call when we think about trade facilitation to move away from just a focus on aggregate analyses. There are so many other factors that we would have to control for to work out whether a TFA in a post hoc analysis would ever actually result in increased trade flows, that it makes it almost a fruitless endeavor unless we have some very on-the-ground studies that look at exactly what's going on. So just to put some other things on the table that we all know. You know, it's actually more than just about smoothing over customs procedures. It's about making sure that there are sufficiently trained staff at border posts to increase the opening hours of these border posts, widening the buildings that are there, making sure that there's the physical infrastructure that trucks can cross, making sure that there are facilities at the side that deal with all the other requirements that we might have in mind when we think about trade facilitation. We need also to think about some of the cultural aspects of trading across borders, about how you actually break down second economy procedures that often stop some small traders from benefiting from trade across borders. So here I'm thinking about some of the networks that some traders find themselves having to engage in to pay bribes to get goods across borders. Now that does two things. One, it includes the hidden cross for trade of those small traders, but it excludes those people that have no access to those networks in the first place. So we need to find ways to break those down. we also need to improve knowledge about how you actually trade across borders. This is the capabilities line that Jody was pushing on a very micro basis. And it's really significant. It's something a TFA cannot possibly hope to do. But it will very much have a real-world advantage should LDCs be able to just make these small adjustments and improvements. We also need to think about the spillover effects of what happens when you increase the capacity of traders to use particular border crossings. You can generate ever greater local economies around border crossings that have multiplier effects, that bring people who sell services in and around the local environment. That's really very important, and we forget about that. So I think we should throw that back into the conversation. And also this comes with some other non-trade issues that we might want to think about. You know, it comes with healthcare education about those people who are actually crossing borders to prevent the spread of disease. Very important in an African context, but also across the rest of the world. It's not just confined to what we tend to think it's confined to, and that's agricultural produce and livestock. But this is where I find myself continually frustrated that the multilateral trading system is not connected up more properly with the UN system, because providing basic levels of human security will go an awful long way to actually facilitating trade. Now here we're thinking about not only movements of people across borders, but also the restriction of the movement of some kinds of people across borders, particularly those who are trafficked for sex work and other work. The kind of trade that we talked about a moment ago, that I think Jamie DeMello talked about, that there are some illegal forms of trade that we should try and restrict. So there's a peace and security dimension to this that I think we should throw into the conversation. I think I'll leave it there. I really would want to stand up here and make a plea for thinking about the micro and thinking about teasing out actually how we can best enable goods to cross borders, but by doing that, through all of us getting on trucks and crossing borders with that trade to work out what works best and moving away from our general equilibrium models. Thank you.
Rodin promised not to talk about the big picture, but at the end of the day, you spoke about the big picture, you know. And it is always very interesting to hear from political scientists to talk about spillovers and multiplier effects and how it energizes the local economy. You talked about the health issue and also the educational dimension, the issue of spillovers for local economy and definitely the human security issue over there. So I think the whole discourse on trade facilitation has been broadened further and bringing in the human dimension and the cultural elements of it. Colleagues, thank you very much. We have been treated to exciting four presentations and two very interesting feedback from the floor. We will have another, since we started 10, 15 minutes late, I will take away 10 minutes from your coffee break, and that will give us around the 20 minutes to have a 25 minutes of discussion. Yes, I'm going to recognize the floor. I'm so happy that you are so energetic and responsive. And group 3-4, and please introduce yourself as you make your questions. We will take a round of questions, and then we'll come to the panelists. And you can give the answers yourself in between. So please give the microphone on this side, and then that side, and then we'll come over there. Please. Just be patient. We will come to everybody. We won't go home till we have heard everybody.
Good morning. Thank you, Deb, and thank you, everyone. Fantastic insights. Hannes Schlimmern of WTI Advisors. I am looking at the title of this presentation, of this discussion, and I'm thinking of the context of regional integration and TF, the linkage. I think there is a big elephant in the room that hasn't really attracted the deserved attention yet, that is services, or more precisely trade in services, because for the services side itself is obvious, that has a lot to do with the capabilities. I think the last speaker, sorry, Rodin, right, mentioned the need for services in and around, or the benefit for services in and around border posts, but what I'm talking about is the services that could oil the machine, that could provide the capabilities, that can link markets, that can enable small traders to actually know what's happening on the other side of the borders because they have colleagues and friends and service providers they trust. The sheer role of FedEx in US businesses having the trust to export to China 25 years ago is staggering, and that's just one example. This, in an interregional context, in the context of LDCs, is happening far too little. The obstacles to trade in services are gigantic. They're not talked about, except transportation. That does attract some attention. I'm talking about a lot more than that. And I think these services need to be talked about yesterday. TF alone is important. Customs is just a subset, as we heard many times today. But especially for interregional integration, services are a big problem. Thanks.
Excellent point. I think so. That was the trade in services, the importance of it for the trade facilitation, which we didn't discuss so much over here. Yes, please. Thank you. I didn't get your name. WTI Institute, I know. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Eugene Torero. I work with Trade Markets Africa, and I'm responsible for trade facilitation. And thank you for the insightful discussion and for all the presentations, but I'm very excited by your comments. You are Rodini? Yeah, I'm really excited by your comments. And I'll say the reasons. We have been supporting ESE countries in trying to improve their trade environment on trade facilitation. Customs services have improved their systems. They are more transparent. They have implemented electronic single window systems. Small traders like women are able to declare offline from on buses from Nairobi, from Kenya, Uganda to Rwanda. And when they get to the border, they find their goods already paid through the mobile money payment system, which is really good. However, it is still import trade facilitation. Can we change that towards his thinking? And I'm thinking of the aid for trade. Can we change that? I'm just for a moment going to suggest aid for increased market access. Nationally, where we have big companies working with small traders on market linkages, so they are able to supply, to buy from the small traders, if they are not able to produce their quality, can they use their corporate social responsibility to support them actually be able to trade? Where is the corporate social responsibility going? Bars and all that. Number two, can we have information available to the small traders to trade regionally? So they are able to sell to NACMATs, to the Walmarts of the regions, just an example. Can we also support them to have global access to markets? I think that would be a game changer. Based on that, can we change the indicators of measuring the impact of aid for trade or the impact for increased market access? So that we do not measure time from time it takes to import from the port of Mombasa to the final point of destination. And we are looking at how much time has it taken a producer to sell, number one, to the producer in the country, to the NACMAT supermarket in the within the region, to the export market in the final destination. And can we change the indicators of measuring increased reduction in the cost to the amount of FDIs that have come into these low developed countries, and therefore probably that will also change the way things
Thank are. You very Thank much. You. Usually you show red card, I show white card. Huh? You know, I think very important points, using CSR for the trade facilitation and addressing the knowledge asymmetry or information asymmetry for regional markets. Please. Yes, two over here, then I will come to this side. The gentleman is, please be patient. Eh? Trade facilitation takes time.
My name is Wumi Olaiwola from ECOWAS Commission, Abuja. Thank you very much. Two quick ones. First, I want to ask, is there any specific export potential in TFE? And secondly,
Would you kindly repeat once again?
Is there any specific export potential in trade facilitation agreement? Potential. That's the first one. And the second one is looking at the peculiarities of African economies. Is there any specific suggestion on how African countries can enhance its export potential via this trade facilitation agreement? Because to be sincere with you, we believe quite a lot that TFE is mainly about imports. And unless we try as much as possible to tap the potential of export within the agreement, it will be very, very difficult to have a buy-in into the domestic economy of African
and
economy.
Just a question, but most of these countries have done DTIS, the diagnostic studies.
Yes.
So that should have shown their export potential up to a point?
No, just categorization to A, B, C, that's all.
Okay, thank you. So there are two concrete questions. Please, on the right side, you hold on. I want to be a leftist now. Please.
Thank you, Mr. Shema. My name is Moses from Nigeria, Nigerian Shepherds Council. I'm so thrilled by the presentation by Rodney. It seems as if we're just dwelling on the high side. We're speaking the jargons, and it doesn't trickle down to the basics. The basics is making it easy for SMEs to do their trading so that it can benefit them and benefit the national economy. I think the challenge here is to get the government to see that trade facilitation is in their own interest. Because if trade moves forward, there is a progress individually for the traders and for the nations, and the nation benefit and the sub-region, the whole Africa benefits. So I think we have to find a way of engaging the policymakers, engaging those people who can implement, who can see that these issues we're talking about is in the interest of the nation and the government. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I think this is, well, those who will be also responding here, please think about one issue which Nicholas was mentioning. He is saying there is an incentive failure. There's so much, there will be loss of, you know, hidden income for individuals. There will be, you know, less employment and many other things. Does those kind of engagement, my colleague from Nigeria is saying, will break that disincentive or not? Or we need something else? What are the, usually the beneficiary of the changes are really silent, and how do you really bring in them as an actor in the process and etc.? Because those who are going, the losers, the potential losers are more active, or they can do impediments than the potential gainers. Why the entrepreneurs cannot really come in and do the changes? That is, how do you make those changes? Please, come. I take you and then to Dirk. Please, then Famida. I know you, Famida, you raised hand earlier, but since you are part of the organizers, you'll have to wait.
Thank you very much. First of all, I want to take this opportunity to thank the presenters for a very elaborate and really thought-provoking presentations on the issue that is in front of us. I really took note of the last critic.
Would you introduce yourself?
Oh, my name is Getahun Seifu. I am from Ethiopia, but I work here in Nairobi in an organization called the Eastern Africa Standby Force. It is a peace and security organization, but I am a trade lawyer, so I am here. What I wanted to ask is related to peace and security, relating to this LDCs, regional integration, and also trade facilitation. The last critic here raised issues of public security as one of the challenges in facilitating trade in LDCs. I've been really looking at all the sessions all around. Apart from one session we talked about illicit trade in natural resources, there's no reference to challenges of peace and security, in particularly this developing world. To me, it seems that trade and development is being highly hindered or hampered in these countries because of conflict situations. Okay, we can have so many agreements in place, we can have so many funds around to support, but if there's no peace and security in the countries, there's no confidence for the countries to trade among each other, and there's no incentive. Classic example, you can take South Sudan, which was forced to close their taps, and now you know where they are. Central African Republic, you can talk about Burundi, you can talk about the ECAS region as a region. Last time there was a presentation where it was observed that the least integrated region in terms of intra-Africa trade is the ECAS region. You go to the north, the northern, it is even the worst. Now, what I wanted to know is from this panel, and also if there is anybody else, if there is any study that was done on how much these conflicts are affecting regional integration in Africa, and also, you know, development of international trade. How much is it affecting? What is it doing? And what should we do as WTO or as other actors in this area of business?
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
I think that's a very important point. In that way, peace and security being a global public good or a regional public good or a national public good, in their absence, how it affects trade and whether trade facilitation really takes into account those broader issues. Once again, I will come to you, ma'am. Oh, Dirk William.
Yeah, Deb, thank you very much. This is a very interesting discussion, and I wanted to pick up some of the issues raised by Rawdon and by a number of other speakers already. We've just finalized a range of impact studies on the effects of regional infrastructure on trade facilitation and on poverty reduction and the growth potential. And we have looked at some of the informal trade and the impact of regional infrastructure on informal trade around monster border posts. And we do find that it is important for informal traders, and there might be some informal traders or informal workers who were dependent on inefficiencies around the border that may have lost out. And of course, you need to take that into account in your design of the one-stop border post and think around those issues. But I think the bigger issue that we found in our work is that you need to think about the indirect effects of regional infrastructure and trade facilitation. It's not just that you need to look at the direct effects on the border only, because it's so important to think about the indirect effects, about the productivity effects that you get through increased competition, better importing, you can import higher quality products, but also exporting, and regional exporters also are more productive because of trade facilitation, that places a different emphasis on the importance of trade facilitation. So if we keep on thinking only about the short run effects, only around the border, and we think only about general equilibrium models that have losers and gainers that are framed in a static way, we lose the bigger picture. And we need to think about this bigger picture that there are long-term effects. And our studies have shown that regional infrastructure do lead to better connectivity, which lead to value chain integration. They do lead to higher productivity. And I think it's important to make that point, because otherwise it's too easy to say, well, there are some people that lose out in a static way, let's not bother about the program. And there are programs that have been, so not TMEA, but TMSA, for example, has been disbanded, and it's now important to think about what can be the next step in the area of Southern Africa.
Thank you, Dirk William. I think that's, again, bringing up the broader issues, both horizontally and vertically, because Rawdon had been talking about in the horizontal sense, the broader issues. Now, Dirk William brought in the other, in the time issues, in the not only space, but in time, short-term and the medium-term impact on productivity and other issues. Let me see the final round of raise of hands. One, two, three, four, and that closes the floor. And you have half a minute each. let me start with Famida, then I will, ma'am, I will come to you, and then I will go there, and then the final one over here.
Thank you, the panel. Excellent deliberations from all the speakers. I have a question and a comment. The question is to Jyoti, maybe to the moderator himself also. We know that IPOA, which has been adopted in 2011, it's going to be monitored, going to face the midterm monitoring in 2016. Now we have SDGs also, which in both the targets, in both the agreements, there are actions to be followed for the implementation at the country level. Now, what kind of coherence and synergies are required for the implementation of these goals under both of these agreements at the country level? This is the question. And the comment is that in the discussion of trade facilitation, I think we have been missing one very important aspect of trade these days, because this is e-commerce. Because the rise of electronic commerce is very all over the world, particularly the advanced countries are taking advantage of that. But in the LDCs, and particularly the SMEs, which cannot afford the infrastructure or to, you know, sell their market, their products because of their lack of capacities, they can take advantage of this e-commerce. But not only there are infrastructural problems, and not only they have skills limitations, but also there are complexities with regard to payment. So these, I think, has to be taken into cognizance of this payment and other complexities for trade facilitation. If we cannot capture this market, I think we will be lagging behind, we'll be deprived of a big market. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I think that was also an interesting point. It comes also back to the services issues and others, the e-commerce in many ways. Thank you. Ma'am.
My name is Martha Bore. I'm just a local, simple local woman who came to find out what has the WTO got to do with us. And I'm very impressed at what's going on. Most of you have robbed the wind off my wings. But I loved what Rodden said about the micro, because in Africa, the least developed countries, women are the backbone of what happens, and usually they're poor women. I am here to empower women and to pull them together to get muscle in cooperatives to do trade up there. You guys are talking up here, and I'm looking and I'm saying, what has this woman here got to do? Because communities sit on our shoulders. So is there anything that you do? These are the soft elements here. But is there a study or anything help that can come down to the woman to know how she can trade at those levels?
Thank you.
I'm from Nairobi here. I'm a Kenyan. Yes.
Thank you. Let's give it a round. Please.
Hello. Okay, thank you very much. My name is Tahir Idris. I come from Nigerian Ports Council. My organization is the economic regulator of this, the port sector in Nigeria. And in that capacity, we coordinate the easy flow of transit cargo into our neighboring landlocked countries of Niger and Chad through a number of means, one of which is the establishment of dry ports, inland container depots, close to the borders of the two nations. Now, my specific question is whether, in pursuing this project, we stand a chance of benefiting from the funds just raised by the World Bank, Aid for Trade, towards the establishment of dry ports to facilitate transit cargo into our landlocked countries. Thank you.
Thank you. Another very concrete suggestion and the possibilities on that. Thank you very much on that. So the last comment from the floor, and before I come back on the rounding up to the panelists and if possible to the discussants, just to let you, alert you, you have an evaluation form on the table on your tiers. Please take 2 minutes and fill them up. This is not a requirement for the organizers of the session, but the organizers of the TDS. So please, if possible, please do the helpful thing to improve the performances in the coming days for us. Please.
My name is Franklin Williams from the Sierra Leone Business Forum. I just want to know from the panel, to what extent does political will or the lack of it affect trade facilitation? And have any studies been done to assess this in African countries in particular? Thank you very much.
Thank you. I think that will again link up to the issue of incentives in terms of change. How do you really bring the theory of change over here to change the conduct of certain agents and to go to a much more improved balance or equilibrium in that way. Colleagues, may I request you one thing? Give a big hand to all the 10 interventions which have come from the floor. They were excellent. I think they have done justice to the theme. They have broadened it both in conceptually and also in operational practical terms. I'm really very, very impressed by the feedback. Thank you very much. Now, we have 5 or 6 minutes left. I will give 1 minute each to the panelists to say their, to pick any question or say something which they missed out, or they would be not be able to sleep at night if they have not shared that thought today at this moment. So that is their last chance in that way. And then if, let me see, I will bring in for half a minute to my distinguished discussants. So let me start with Jim. And whatever you pick up, or you cluster them, please do.
Very quickly, I just will put the plug. We wrote a book last year that's now available online on the Vox EU, which is on evaluating aid for trade. What have we learned? Where are we going? And many of the questions that were asked here are addressed. And one of the basic ones is, well, we have to go towards better evaluation. All these questions that you ask are very good. They're all difficult ones to answer. And that's because we don't have the equivalent of what you would call in medicine the ability to have control experiments. It's very difficult to do so. There are efforts to do it, but this is something really we have to lean and spend more time on. So I would urge that we go in that direction when we're looking at aid for trade. Try and find out what would be more or less the counterfactual. What would have happened if we had not had that aid for trade intervention? And here, the trade facilitation agreement, it's only a very small part, but it is something that you can more or less measure, and that was the point of the presentation. Thank you.
Thank you. I think that's an important point, that the inadequacy of the methodology, or also the data availability, that is, and given the amount of money we use, is it worth spending so much money on researchers like us? Jody.
Thank you. I think there was one question that was specifically addressed to me, and regarding the IPOA and the SDGs, and in terms of implementation. I would say that at the moment, we're still reviewing the overlap and synergies between the two, the objectives between both of these goals, sets of goals. There are areas of synergy. There are also some gaps, though. Okay, so that work's still ongoing. I think I'm just delighted by the interventions, all of the interventions from the floor, because they're all kind of agreeing on this issue of capabilities and getting back to the micro foundations of participation. So I'm really delighted, actually, that these issues have arisen. And I think there's much work to be done on the methodological side and thinking through impact assessments. And I think I'll just give one reference to the new trade strategy that was launched by the European Commission, new trade commissioner. And she has recognized that an important gap in terms of impact assessments relating to the implementation of trade agreements, particularly for LDCs. Okay, so this gap is recognized, and I think we're now moving into what can be done about it.
Thank you, Judy, for that. Ratnakar?
Yeah, the first question that I want to respond to is about, just the question coming from you, and I find this very, very important, and this is something that we have done, actually. We're proud to say that we've done. This in Mali, for example, where we have provided necessary training to the women cooperative, member of women cooperative, to be able to export to the European market. And they have successfully done that. We've done this in Cambodia to provide necessary market linkage opportunity to the silk weavers and some of the farms, women-owned farms, to be able to compete internationally and export into the international market. We are providing, as we speak, support in Rwanda. This is the project that I just mentioned, but due to lack of time, I couldn't explain in detail. But this, the project, trade facilitation project in Rwanda, also has a component of providing capacity building training to the women traders to be able to trade better and creating the infrastructure where women traders can trade in a safe environment and can pass across the border in a safe environment without harassment and bullying from their male officials sitting there at the border. So these are the type of things that we are doing, and I'll leave this with you, some of the impact stories here, and some of those are here. So that's one, and another thing, I wouldn't be able to sleep tonight if I do not respond to this question. And this issue, actually, and this was raised. See, in the case of LDCs, I think what we have to understand is that whether it's trade facilitation agreement or not, trade facilitation is important. It is critical for LDCs, not only for export, but also for imports. Imports are important even for exports. So this is something that we have to understand, number one, and this is going to be extremely, extremely critical for the SMEs. So therefore, whether it's a capacity deficit, whether it's the resource constraint, whether it's any other issues, these are the type of issues that need to be fixed so that, you know, we don't have to come back here in 20 years' time and ask the same question whether the goods that Nicholas was mentioning about would still be imported from the UK and not from the neighboring countries in ECOWAS. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Next 20 years, I won't be there. Maybe it is your good luck.
No, I would like to express deep gratitude for all the excellent questions. Sort of allows us to also rethink our positions. And so thank you very much. I think that the issue of SMEs and services have come up very strongly, I think, at the micro level. I think this is very important. In fact, trade in goods and trade in services cannot be bifurcated anymore. Many of the services are embedded in trade in goods. So the observation was very well taken that if we don't do the e-commerce, as Pamida has mentioned, the banking sector services, etc., trade facilitation, just moving the goods will not do the trick. So services are very important. In fact, for example, in South Asia, after we have done the free trade agreement, we are now doing the CETIS, SARC trade in services, because we have understood the problems that that are there if you only have goods cooperation but not in services. The question was raised with regard to trade facilitation agreement and its interconnectivity with exports. Now, I was telling that when it was being negotiated, some people criticized that it is trade facilitation is indeed import facilitation because it's on the customs, etc., and it is not going into infrastructure and those big things which are needed by the LDCs. But at the same time, I would also say that even if it is import, it is also beneficial to the consumers. It is beneficial to the importers of inputs which go into export-oriented industries and producers. So I think that it will not be fair to say that it is only helping the imports but not the exports. The other point, yes, very well taken. I think conflict and the trade. But I think that in order to prevent future conflicts, trade and trade facilitation plays an important role. I read that if goods don't cross the border, troops will. So I think to prevent future conflicts, I think trade plays a role. And the last point with regard to transit cargo. In the trade facilitation agreement, out of the 38 measures, transit is a concrete measure which has been taken. So it is now our obligation as part of the trade facilitation agreement to facilitate transit, trade in transit cargo. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Rodden has been very helpful. He left, and so I don't have to give him time. So, Nicholas, 30 seconds. 30 seconds means half a minute, huh?
Thank you very much. I will be short. First of all, trade facilitation services. I think trade facilitation is services. Even the customs is supposed to be a service. Often it is a disservice. But clearly we have to work a lot of that. But the role of the private sector there should be also helping because we have a capacity problem at the level of the government. The second point is public security and trade facilitation. I think they are independent issues in the sense that we have an issue of public security. Trade facilitation doesn't mean no control. It means efficient controls. It's just that we have to change if we have a problem. But it should be useful in both situations, whether peace or things. The last question and the most important one is the lady from Kenya. As long as we cannot respond to her, we are useless speaking about the billions of benefits that we get because she wonders, without reason, what does that mean? Where are they, those billions? But you are on the wrong address. We are not able to do that. We are looking at the global picture. But your government has to be able to respond to that question. So there has to be a transposition of these general principles down to the micro level at your government levels. So, I mean, you should insist on your government to see where are those billions. I want to see something of it. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, give a big hand to all the other. Colleagues, the role of the moderator, as you know, he has to be either a pretty face or a good timekeeper. I try to be the second one. Huh? So thank you very much. It was a very, very exciting meeting. I liked it very much myself, enjoyed it. And what I see that we started the discussions on the costs and resources issue. Then we moved on to the issue of incentives and institutions, and then to capacities. And then we talked about all the linkages, spillovers, and externalities. And finally, we came to global public goods on security and others. I think what a good discussion and a wide-ranging one in that way. It only shows that Mustafiz or Jody and Jim will have to reinvent their own research program on it for the next 2 years in many ways, and we'll get some answers and come back with concrete issues over there. Thank you very much for being here with us today, and I think we have done a bit more improved our understanding about the complexity of this triangulation of LDC, connectivity, trade facilitation, and regional integration. Have a good day. Thank you.